Mark Goulston.
I'm Jeff Brown.
And we make up the Zo What Morning Show. You can find us here on TradioV.com every Monday at 11 a.m. Pacific Standard Time. I make you think.
He makes you laugh. And if I get a chance, I'll help you change.
Or make you cry with his attempts at humor.
Radio in TV.
Can you relate? We'll make it happen.
Look at Jeff. What you doing?
Were you mumbling to yourself?
He back there mumbling.
To them. To them.
And it's Mary Carey, of course, politically naughty with Mary Carey.
I'm always naughty. I'm always politically. My behavior is always
politically naughty.
I'm never politically correct.
Dr. Drew,
hi. Oh, I'm so
excited. How are you?
All teary-eyed, doctor.
I know. She wishes she could live at rehab.
But only if Dr. Drew's there. Obviously,
sure.
Plus one, like, you know, because a little groping might be inappropriate, but I like the flirting. Well,
when I walked in, you shoved my head in your...
No! Are you going to sue me?
Get politically naughty with Mary Carey, Mondays at 4 p.m. on TRadioV.
Yo, what's up? This is your boy Kyle Mass, and you're checking out TRadioV.
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 Hello, TRadioV. Love you guys.
Radio in TV.
Hey, my fellow thoughters out there, I'm Charles Shaughnessy. Check out my new show, Here's a Thought with Charles Shaughnessy, August the 7th, 3 p.m. PST, right here on TRadioV. Now, you know I have a lot to say, but I want to hear what you have to say. So tune in, grab your phones, call me, tweet me, email me in the studio, and let's get this conversation going. Here's a Thought, starting August the 7th, 3 p.m. PST, right here on TRadioV. Let's radio... in TV.
Yo, what's up? This is your boy Kyle Mass, and you're checking out TRadioV.
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 Hello, TRadioV. Love you guys.
Radio in TV.
Radio in TV.
TRadioV.
What did you play opposite Andy, Eric? Do you remember?
Andy and I worked as two employees at a network.
Okay. Oh, you're and forgetting the other thing.
I played a news anchor, and he played a reporter.
Okay, but the other thing you did, the thing you did on the Andy Dick show, who did you play to Andy?
Hey, my fellow thoughters out there. I'm Charles Shaughnessy. Check out my new show, Here's a Thought with Charles Shaughnessy, August the 7th, 3 p.m. PST, right here on TRadioV. Now, you know I have a lot to say, but I want to hear what you have to say. So tune in, grab your phones, call me, tweet me, email me in the studio, and let's get this conversation going. Here's a Thought, starting August the 7th, 3 p.m. PST, right here on TRadioV. Let's radio in TV.
Yo, what's up? This is your boy Kyle Mass, and you're checking out TRadioV.
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 Hello, TRadioV. Love you guys.
Radio in TV.
Radio in TV.
TRadioV.
What did you play opposite Andy, Eric? Do you remember?
Andy and I worked as two employees at a network.
Okay.
Oh, you're and forgetting the other thing.
I played a news anchor, and he played a reporter.
Okay, but the other thing you did, the thing you did on the Andy Dick show, who did you play to Andy?
Is that going to play my sister?
You played his wife, Denise.
Yeah.
Yeah, you played his wife.
Yeah. So what's wrong with that, Eliza? Yeah.
Nothing's wrong with it.
He's got a great range as an actor.
Yeah, it just was funny.
Encounters with Eric and Eliza Roberts, Wednesdays from 2 to 4 p.m. on TRadioV.
Hey, I'm Dean Cain, and you are watching TRadioV. I'm watching it too. Right now. Seriously.
Andy D on TRadioV.
Bing, bang, bing, boom, right?
Yeah.
Andy D on TRadioV. Bobbity, bibbity, bobbity, boom. Andy D on TRadioV.
The Andy Dick Show, Wednesdays from 4 to 6 p.m. on TRadioV.
Wow! So but Paul, we'll do it better when the show actually starts. Yeah, no.
Hey, hello, hello, this is David Faustino, and you are watching T-Radio V. Do you see what I'm saying? It's television crossed with radio. It's all together. It's weird. Radio's in the middle of it. It's amazing. You're watching it. Go.
Love and marriage, love and marriage.
Hey, my fellow thoughters out there. I'm Charles Shaughnessy. Check out my new show, Here's a Thought with Charles Shaughnessy, August the 7th, 3 p.m. PST, right here on T-Radio V. Now, you know I have a lot to say, but I want to hear what you have to say. So tune in, grab your phones, call me, tweet me, email me in the studio, and let's get this conversation going. Here's a Thought, starting August the 7th, 3 p.m. PST, right here on T-Radio V. That's radio in TV.
Radio V.
What did you play opposite Andy, Eric? Do you remember?
Andy and I worked as two employees at a network.
Okay. Oh, you're and forgetting the other thing.
I played a news anchor, and he played a reporter.
Okay, but the other thing you did, the thing you did on the Andy Dick Show, who did you play to Andy?
Oh, is that going to play my sister?
You played his wife, Denise.
Yeah.
Yeah, you played his wife.
Yeah. So what's wrong with that, Eliza? Yeah.
Nothing's wrong with it.
He's got a great range as an actor.
Yeah, it just was funny.
Encounters with Eric and Eliza Roberts, Wednesdays from 2 to 4 p.m. on T-Radio V.
Andy D on T-Radio V. Bing, bang, bing, boom, right?
Yeah.
Andy D on T-Radio V. Bobbity, bibbity, bobbity, boo. Andy D on T-Radio V.
The Andy Dick Show, Wednesdays from 4 to 6 p.m. on T-Radio V.
Wow! So but Paul, we'll do it better when the show actually starts. Yeah, no.
Hey geeks, wake up, we've got big news. I'm not gonna mumble this time. Geekscape, the long-running movie video game. Let me do one more. Hey geeks, we got big news! Geekscape, your favorite show about movies, video games, comics, and TV, is coming to T-Radio V Monday, October 6th. And it'll be on every Monday from then on, 7 p.m. Until the apocalypse happens, we're all eaten by zombies.
I'm Zoe Williams.
And I'm Dr. Mark Goulston.
I'm Jeff Brown.
And we make up the Zoe What Morning Show. You can find us here on TRadioV.com every Monday at 11 a.m. Pacific Standard Time. I make you think.
He makes you laugh. And if I get a chance, I'll help you change.
Or make you cry with his attempts at humor.
Radio in TV.
Can you relate? We'll make it happen.
Look at Jeff. What you doing?
Were you mumbling to yourself?
Hey, back there mumbling.
To them. To them.
And it's Mary Carey, of course, politically naughty with Mary Carey.
I'm always naughty. I'm always politically. My behavior is always politically naughty. I'm never politically correct.
Dr. Drew,
hi. Oh, I'm so
guys, how are you?
All teary-eyed, doctor.
I know. She wished she could live at rehab.
But only if Dr. Drew's there. Obviously, sure. Plus one, like, you know, because a little too groping might be inappropriate, but I like the flirting. Well, and stuff.
When I walked in, you shoved my head in your...
No! Are you going to sue me?
Get politically naughty with Mary Carey, Mondays at 4 p.m. on T-Radio V.
Yo, what's up? This is your boy Kyle Mass, and you're checking out T-Radio V.
T-Radio V.
T-Radio V.
Hello, T-Radio V. Love you guys.
Radio in TV.
Yo, what's up? This is your boy Kyle Mass, and you're checking out T-Radio V.
T-Radio V.
T-Radio V.
Hello, T-Radio V. Love you guys.
Radio in TV.
Radio in TV.
T-Radio V.
What did you play opposite Andy, Eric? Do you remember?
Andy and I worked as two employees at a network.
Okay.
Oh, you're and forgetting the other thing.
I played a news anchor, and he played a reporter.
Okay, but the other thing you did, the thing you did on the Andy Dick Show, who did you play to Andy?
Oh, is that going to play my sister?
You played his wife, Denise.
Yeah.
Yeah, you played his wife.
Yeah. So what's wrong with that, Eliza? Yeah.
Nothing's wrong with it.
He's got a great range as an actor.
Yeah, it just was funny.
Encounters with Eric and Eliza Roberts, Wednesdays from 2 to 4 p.m. on T-Radio V.
Andy D on to Radio V. Bing, bang, bing, boom, right?
Yeah.
Andy D. Auntie Radio V. Bobbity, bibbity, bobbity, boo. Andy D. Andy D. Auntie Radio V. Bing, bang, bing, boom, right?
Yeah.
Andy D. Auntie Radio V. Bobbity, bibbity, bobbity, boo. Andy D. Auntie Radio V.
The Andy Dick Show, Wednesdays from 4 to 6 p.m. on T Radio V.
Wow!
So but Paul, we'll do it better when the show actually starts. Yeah, no.
Yo, what's up? This is your boy Kyle Mass, and you're checking out T-Radio V.
T-Radio V.
T-Radio V.
Hello, T-Radio V. Love you guys.
Radio in TV.
Radio in TV.
T-Radio V.
What did you play opposite Andy, Eric? Do you remember?
Andy and I worked as two employees at a network.
Okay.
Oh, you're and forgetting the other thing.
I played a news anchor, and you played a reporter.
Okay, but the other thing you did, the thing you did on the Andy Dick Show, who did you play to Andy?
Oh, is that play my sister?
You played his wife, Denise.
Yeah.
Yeah, you played his wife.
Yeah. So what's wrong with that, Eli? Yeah.
Nothing's wrong with it.
He's got a great range as an actor.
Yeah, it just was funny.
Encounters with Eric and Eliza Roberts, Wednesdays from 2 to 4 p.m. on T Radio V.
Hey, I'm Dean Cain, and you are watching T Radio V. I'm watching it too. Right now. Seriously.
Andy D. Auntie Radio V. Bing, bang, bing, boom, right?
Yeah.
Andy D. Auntie Radio V. Bobbity, bibbity, bobbity, boo. Andy D. Auntie Radio V.
The Andy Dick Show, Wednesdays from 4 to 6 p.m. on T Radio V.
Wow!
So but Paul, we'll do it better when the show actually starts.
Yeah, no.
Hey, hello, this is David Faustino, and you are watching T Radio V. Do you see what I'm saying? It's television crossed with radio. It's all together. It's weird. Radio's in the middle of it. It's amazing. You're watching it. Go.
Love and marriage, love and marriage.
Hey, my fellow thoughters out there. I'm Charles Shaughnessy. Check out my new show, Here's a Thought with Charles Shaughnessy, August the 7th, 3 p.m. PST, right here on T-Radio V. Now, you know I have a lot to say, but I want to hear what you have to say. So tune in, grab your phones, call me, tweet me, email me in the studio, and let's get this conversation going. Here's a Thought, starting August the 7th, 3 p.m. PST, right here on T-Radio V. That's radio in TV.
Hey, Bob, you know, with the state of rock radio, do you feel like shows like yours and the CMS and others are going to have to carry the torch of metal? You know, metal's always been an underground movement, but do you think it's up to those kind of shows to actually get the music out to the people?
Absolutely. They're the only shows doing it. You know, who else is playing Iron Maiden, Hollow Be Thy Name? It's ridiculous.
And now, here is your host, Bob Nalbandian.
Check, check.
Love you, bye.
Hey, Bob, you know, with the state of rock radio, do you feel like shows like yours and the CMS and others are going to have to carry the torch of metal? You know, metal's always been an underground movement, but do you think it's up to those kind of shows to actually get the music out to the people?
Absolutely. They're the only shows doing it. You know, who else is playing Iron Maiden, Hollow Be Thy Name? It's ridiculous.
And now, here is your host, Bob Nalbandian.
Love you, bye.
Whoa, guy, are we done there? Gotta love that. The wheezy bumper. Done for the Classic Metal Show and the Inside Metal Show here on T-Radio V. I'm your host, Bob Nalbandian. We have a great, great show. Of course, my co-host, Miss Jasmin St. Clair.
Hi.
And inside metal, I guess, kind of goes inside punk today,
yes.
Man. We got some legends here. Brothers, Mr. Lucky Lehrer and Chet Lehrer. The brothers from Circle Jerks and Wasted Youth.
Yeah, so go ahead and flash that graphic.
Yeah, let's get the Circle Jerks. How about Circle Jerks at the Whiskey Marquee? If we find that, we got...
We have to.
Yeah. So listen, we got, you know, we did a big Lemmy tribute on our last show. And I know you guys were just at the Rainbow for the Lemmy Memorial service. And I was out there and out there for the Metal Allegiance show. And still a lot of grieving. And then it just hit us the other day, of course. Another true, true legend icon, David Bowie, had passed away. And I know how much of an influence, of course, Bowie was to the punk rock music scene, amongst many other things. He was one of those artists that crossed over so many musical boundaries. So let's go ahead and start off the show. I know you've got a lot to say, Lucky and Chet. Why don't you talk about Lemmy for one? I know you're wearing a Motorhead shirt here. And Motorhead.
Well, Chet brought some special stuff to show that most people probably haven't seen from Lemmy. And just going back to the Bowie thing before you get to that, obviously the guy's incredibly influential to so many different people. I was in high school along with Darby Crash, who was in the Germs, and Pat Smear, Foo Fighters, and Paul Rossler of Screamers, and his sister Kira playing in Black Flag. And I could tell you all of us were deeply influenced by Bowie, and it's a huge loss. The guy was a thunderbolt. He continued to recreate himself. He played in every genre, and he was always super confident. So that's my two-second tribute to David Bowie.
Yeah. And
turning to Lemmy, it was an incredible outpouring on the Sunset Strip on the day of the funeral. We headed up there after hearing a great eulogy by Lars, and I mean, the Rainbow was filled. The
Beyond
Roxy
filled.
Was wall-to-wall. Whiskey Go-Go was going off in the Viper Room, all playing Lemmy music. And he had an incredible impact by bridging the two different worlds that previously you'd be either a metal person or you were punk or you were this or that. And he was kind of enveloped everyone's style.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And that's something I definitely want to, we'll get to a little bit later, how Lemmy, because back in the day, a lot of people don't remember, and I grew up in that era, when metal and punk were completely separate. You either liked one or the other, and it was a big feud. And Motorhead really fused that together. I remember seeing their Hollywood Palladium show, which I'm sure you were at, when Brian Robertson played guitar on the Iron Fist tour, and Brian had just joined the band. That was probably the first show in L.A. where I actually saw metalheads and punks in the same venue getting along. And I remember we were like, you know, I was a young kid then, and we saw... After the opening band played, I can't remember if Crocus was on that bill. I don't remember if they closed or Motorhead closed, but I think actually Motorhead closed. After Crocus ended, all the punks started coming in, and we're thinking, fuck, a riot's going to break out, you know? And everyone, and that was kind of the first show that I remember where people were moshing together, and it was cool. Except it wasn't too. They weren't too cool to Brian Robertson. They were spitting on him constantly.
That's
which,
not good.
Yeah, I think annoyed him. But
I had a similar experience going to a Living Color concert.
Really?
Where a lot of punks showed up.
At Living Color?
Yes.
Yeah,
and they started the mosh pit. The band actually, uncool as it sounds, they stopped playing.
Why?
I was like, whoa, you guys are in L.A. You're playing fast tempo music.
Yeah.
You should have been.
Was that at the Palace?
I think that was the Palladium also.
Okay.
Yeah.
I saw them at the Whiskey and then at the Palace when they first...
Anyway, let's look at some of this rare stuff that Chet brought.
I got to see this.
Chet, we got... Chet, of course, from Wasted Youth. And the band's still doing shows, correct?
Really not at the moment, no. But we certainly had a nice run from 80 to...
You know, you guys got to really suck up to these mics because they don't...
don't pick up the sound that well.
Yeah. There you go. So,
okay.
but why don't we talk about some of the cool stuff you have here?
Start off with, I bought my
cool
Bowie shirt that I've had. It's a little beat up, but this is a concert I went to in 78.
And you cut the sleeves off. It was a baseball jersey.
It's kind of like I shouldn't have really.
So that was after Young Americans. That would have been 78. What was the album? Young Americans was like 76. And
that might have been Heroes.
It was
That's
Heroes,
pretty
I
cool.
Think, yeah.
Thanks.
Very different.
It's near and dear to my heart.
It's like musical icons now. You guys, you know, you always see a Wasted Youth, Bad Religion, and Circle Jerk stuff all over the place. And then you have like Motorhead and Bowie.
Well, it's a good segue to point out that most of the players in all these bands are also huge music fans.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And, you know, what's funny is, you know, we'll go back. I mean, obviously, you guys are big metalhead bands and, you know, of course, you know, Motorhead bands, as we discussed. But you really grew up on, and I remember way back in the day, growing up in high school, all the drummers, punks or whatnot, they all looked up to you because you had a major jazz influence. And you were, as far as punk rock goes, one of the most sophisticated drummers on the scene. Everyone talked about, you know, the Circle Jerks. And I remember that first EP when it came out, the 10-inch, when people were doing 10-inches. And I think you even have a Motorhead Girls School 10-inch somewhere in there,
yeah,
I bet.
A bunch of
is that signed?
But that, I remember that, and that was, Lemmy. Yeah,
wow.
There you go.
That's awesome.
And, you know, I met Lemmy over the years a few times, and...
That's a rarity there, the recorded live. Yeah, some... There you go. Another perfect day. What an underrated album that one is.
That one is,
Brian Robertson. Of course, Ace of Spades. Look at that.
That one I love.
That's
the classic lineup.
This is one of my favorites.
That's probably, that's definitely in my top four or five albums of all time. That was a game changer, that album.
And the cover is just so perfect. It's just so well done.
I saw in the record store, and that was the heaviest picture. I was like, oh my God, these guys are fucking brutal.
Yeah, they just look really cool.
Yeah.
In this picture.
Absolutely.
I liked Iron Fist as well.
Yeah. Awesome album. Fast Eddie. The one thing I'm really bummed about is that, you know, everyone knows, you know, Filthy Animal Taylor passed away just months before Lemmy. And he was such a drum icon. I know, being a drummer, and so underrated. And, I mean, the double bass on Overkill, I mean, influenced so many thrash. There
that's
we
it.
Go, the Overkill album.
Oh, what's this one?
That's the Motorhead Girls Go, the 10-inch I was talking about.
I've never seen that.
Yeah.
Can I see that,
please?
Please
Don't Touch, and then Girl School does Bomber, and Motorhead does Emergency,
wow, look
a
at
Girl
this.
School song.
He's in the background in the suit looking all sharp and dapper.
Yeah, that was based on the Al Capone St. Valentine's Day Massacre.
The back of this is really
classic.
Yeah.
It tells another story.
This is the coolest.
I used to have that EP. I used to have all that stuff. I was an idiot. I sold my vinyl collection years ago.
Did
but,
you?
Yeah, I had all that stuff.
Did you sell your old shirts,
not autographed,
though? Like, the old shirts are cool. You see them on eBay as high as, like, $2-something.
Dude, I know. All my
it's
old
insane.
Shirts became dust rags, and then, because I would never throw it away. My mom would, she would try to throw it away, and I would just keep it, and then they ended up, I couldn't wear them
They're
anymore,
too small
so.
For you, and I should just give them to me. I could wear them.
I had the Judas Priest Heavy Metal Masters dust rag. It was the heaviest dust rag ever. So, going back to Bowie, I mean, how many, you know, that's funny, because the... people don't realize how much he influenced, you know, a lot of people say he was like one of the original punks. And as far as hard rock and, you know, before there was hard rock and metal, I mean, I remember I was like 8 years old. I had an older cousin. He used to make me tapes of Zeppelin and Sabbath and stuff. We're talking, you know, early 70s here. And I remember one of the first compilation tapes I had on 8-track. My dad had an 8-track recorder. He came over and made a 8-track tape for me. And it had Sabbath, Deep Purple, Zeppelin, Alice Cooper, 10 Years After, Humble Pie, who am I forgetting? David Bowie. And so to me, David Bowie was a part of that whole hard rock. It was one of the first artists that I grew up on. And I remember the three songs. It was from the Ziggy Stardust album, Ziggy Stardust, Hang On To Yourself, and Suffragette City. And it's like, wow, this, you know, David Bowie to me was a hard rock, you know.
One time Chet said to me, asked, what do you think was the first punk rock song? What was the first that was really influential? Of course, there's no single answer.
Right.
Because so much influenced it, and it's a whole long story, which we won't get into. But do you remember the song you told me that you thought really influenced or it was a game changer?
Yeah.
Which one?
Do you remember which song that was?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Well, Hang On To Yourself.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah,
it was the
gym.
Beginning of the guitarist's quote-unquote downstroke derby. That's what Greg Henson of the Circle Jerks calls it.
Wow. Yeah, that's true. And
well,
it's that rhythm.
Like the lawnmower kind of, you know, when you hear grass being cut. And, you know, definitely you hear it with the Ramones. You hear it with a lot of early British bands. But for me, when I heard that, it really just opened my mind up thinking, hey, this Mick Ronson with David Bowie was probably
that was
the beginnings
best.
Of some really raw sounding kind of punk influenced sounds.
Yeah, the Mick Ronson era, I thought was such that was to me the Bowie era. I kind of lost interest in the 80s, although he still wrote great pop songs,
yeah,
obviously,
I
but.
Mean,
that Mick Ronson's such an underrated guitarist.
Yeah, I mean, that was one of the things with David Bowie. He really played with some of the best musicians ever.
Absolutely.
You know, I mean,
Adrian
he was
Ballou.
Constantly
yeah.
changing the sound, and he evolved. And it's amazing when you think the lineup, the guitarists that he played with, Adrian Ballou and Earl Slick and
sure.
Mick Ronson, and even hooked up with
Stevie Ray Vaughan. Gave him his break.
Amazing guy that just constantly was evolving and changing in his music. And I always thought that he... opened up and let insiders in terms of his lyric writing and his music and touched upon things that not everyone spoke about.
Absolutely. And, we'll talk
about really a true pioneer.
Yeah.
Absolutely. We'll talk about that and get into a little more. I think we're going to have to do a quick break here. All right, and we'll be back in 2 minutes with Lucky and Chet. Okay, you
CMS and others are going to towards that metal. You know, metal's always been an underground movement, but do you think it's up to those kind of shows to actually get the music out to the people?
Absolutely.
T Radio V.
What did you play opposite Andy, Eric? Do you remember?
Andy and I worked as two employees at a network.
Okay.
Oh, you're forgetting the other thing.
I played a news anchor and he played a reporter.
Okay, but the other thing you did, the thing you did on the Andy Dick show, who did you play to Andy?
Oh, is that going to play my sister?
You played his wife, Denise.
Yeah.
Yeah, you played his wife.
Yeah. So what's wrong with that, Eliza? Yeah.
Nothing's wrong with it.
He's got a great range as an actor.
Yeah, it just was funny.
Encounters with Eric and Eliza Roberts, Wednesdays from 2 to 4 p.m. on T Radio V.
T Radio V.
What did you play opposite Andy, Eric? Do you remember?
Andy and I worked as two employees at a network.
Okay.
Oh, you're and forgetting the other thing.
I played a news anchor and... he played a reporter.
Okay, but the other thing you did, the thing you did on the Andy Dick show, who did you play to Andy?
Oh, is that going to play my sister?
You played his wife, Denise.
Yeah.
Yeah, you played his wife.
Yeah. So what's wrong with that, Eliza? Yeah.
Nothing's wrong with it.
He's got a great range as an actor.
Yeah, it just was funny.
Encounters with Eric and Eliza Roberts, Wednesdays from 2 to 4 p.m. on T Radio V.
T Radio V.
What did you play opposite Andy, Eric? Do you remember?
Andy and I worked as two employees at a network.
Okay.
Oh, you're forgetting the other thing.
I played a news anchor and he played a reporter.
Okay, but the other thing you did, the thing you did on the Andy Dick show, who did you play to Andy?
Oh, is that going to play my sister?
You played his wife, Denise.
Yeah.
Yeah, you played his wife.
Yeah. So what's wrong with that, Eliza? Yeah.
Nothing's wrong with it.
He's got a great range as an actor.
Yeah, it just was funny.
Encounters with Eric and Eliza Roberts, Wednesdays from 2 to 4 p.m. on T Radio V.
T Radio V.
What did you play opposite Andy, Eric? Do you remember?
Andy and I.
Hey, I'm Dean Cain, and you are watching T Radio V. I'm watching it too. Right now. Seriously.
Hey, hello, hello, this is David Faustino, and you are watching T Radio V. Do you see what I'm saying? It's television crossed with radio. It's all together. It's weird. Radio's in the middle of it. It's amazing. You're watching it. Go.
Love and marriage, love and marriage.
T Radio V Inside Metal Show. We are back with punk rock and roll legends, let's just say. Lucky and Chet Lehrer from Circle Jerks and Wasted Youth, and of course, the lovely Jasmin St. Clair, my co-host. And we were getting into, we were obviously talking about Bowie and how much he influenced everyone, and of course, Lemmy. But I know you were talking and discussing
questions.
Something.
Pusshead or Pusshead? How do we say it?
Pusshead Lamort.
You guys worked with him on an album. What was that like working with him? Because later on, he evolved into this like really big artist. He did a lot of Metallica albums and so forth. What was your experience like working with him?
Well, I mean, for me going back, I think the Reagan's Inn album cover that we got, I really got the artwork from
you. I think.
You're the guilty party.
We got maybe come to think of it. Maybe.
Yeah. Wow.
I don't know. God.
But somehow we ended up with using his artwork for our album cover. Mm-hmm. And
was he just a local artist at the time?
No, he was a guy, I think, from San Francisco. He was in
that would
Northern
make sense.
California.
Right.
And we used his album, his artwork for our album cover, Reagan's Inn.
Cool.
And it's very cool because it's black and white, monochromatic.
Iconic cover.
Yeah.
Now.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, that's probably one valid point to add is even like the Circle Jerks logo was created by a fan and given. It was a real do-it-yourself movement.
Mm.
And the skank man that's associated with, again, Circle Jerks.
Right.
Again, that was Sean Curry. She was an artist for Hustler.
Oh, cool.
Handed at a, here's something I drew for you guys. Handed to us at a gig for free.
Mm.
No, like, contract, no expectation. So this was the vibe that, you know, put people in context. This is where this great art came from. It was given from the heart without strings attached.
Right.
What do you think of some of the other bands of that era, like Black Flag? Were they any inspiration to you?
Well, I mean, I really was into the early Black Flag.
Yeah.
Pre-Rollins. Yeah, that's I mean, I was into it with Keith Morris, and then that thing, you know, dissolved, and then they had a different lineup with Ron Reyes for a short period of time.
Mm-hmm.
And it was funny, their last show with Ron was at the Fleetwood, and he walked off the stage. He got really pissed off. I quit. And I walked off the stage with him, and I go, Ron, what are you doing? You can't just quit. Get out there and get better. No, I quit the band. I don't want to play with those guys anymore, but... That's that story. And
that
then,
sucks.
And then after Ron came Henry.
Yeah.
And
you had a Henry story.
And then, well, yeah, Henry came. He's from the East Coast. Yeah, D.C., and he was in a band back there, another punk band back there.
What was that band?
SOA or okay. SO. I'm not clear on that. It wasn't Minor Threat. It was some other band back there. SSD Control.
SSD Control.
I'm not sure, but one of those bands. He came to Hollywood. The night he came, I bumped into him. It was actually by a liquor store on Sunset Boulevard, and he was very excited, very happy to say, hey, I'm in the Black Flag, and he was very excited, and I met him that night. It was kind of interesting.
Wow. And when did Keith join Circle Jerks? Was that right after Black Flag?
Yeah.
Right
it
after.
Was, it was one thing led to the other. I had gotten into a band for one day that Chet Lehrer was in called Red Kross.
Right.
But for whatever reason, band. That didn't work out, and they didn't want me.
Mm.
And Greg, the guitarist, didn't like that they didn't want me, so then he quit. And now, okay, now we're both out of a band. Don't worry, I know this guy that sings in a band called Black Flag, and he just quit. So it just evolved once again without a game plan, without a strategy, without management, very
well, it was all do-it-yourself, yeah. And that, you know, I mean, I was telling you guys, I grew up in Huntington at the time, and there was a place called the Cuckoo's Nest, which later became the Concert Factory, where I used to see the first shows of Metallica and Slayer and all that. But before, it was the punk rock haven. You had that place, and that, I know you guys shot the movie, obviously, The First Decline of Western Civilization with the Germs and Circle Jerks, and most of that was shot at the...
Cuckoo's Nest, Fleetwood.
Jerry Roach. Oh, Fleetwood and Redondo.
Fleetwood and Redondo. There's footage from a club called Club 88 that was in West LA.
Yeah.
Oh, boy.
Wow.
And,
that's old school.
Some,
that was
also
like the Rodgers and all that.
The Germs thing was shot at a studio. Okay. I think it's called Gower Studios, like literally two blocks
it's
from here.
The street
wow.
From here, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's crazy. So talk a little bit about that era, because that was a real, I mean, for a young kid, that was a scary era. A lot of my friends were punks, and I was like, you know, 16 at the time. They were trying to take me over there. I would turn them on to like Metallica and Slayer, and they loved that. And Motorhead was the band, again, that tied the punks. So I was kind of cool with the punks, because I presented them Motorhead, and they're like, wow, this is cool. These guys are hippies, but they're fast and they're heavy. You know this, and then I started turning them on. So I was kind of in with this local HB punk crowd, and they were trying to get me into the Cuckoo's Nest. And I heard all the stories about that, and not that I had real long hair, but you know, I heard they'd pin you down, cut your hair, and do all that. It was it was a crazy time. Talk a little bit about that whole era.
Sounds scary.
Well, I think to put things in perspective, you have to tie two different worlds together that ended up meeting. This is my version of the history. People were surfing at POP, and this is part of the like long history. I'll try to condense it. And that was a pier that was taken down that used to have rides we went to as a kid. Mm-hmm. And surfers saw those pylons, those things that used to hold up the pier, as an incredible obstacle course. And this was the beginning of sort of extreme surfing and dangerous surfing.
This is in Venice, right?
This is in Venice.
So the Z Boys in the Dogtown, if you watch that movie, that kind of explains suicidal it. And all those. Yeah,
exactly. And so when the surf was bad, then they'd take to the same thing. Because the old footage of skateboard contests were people doing handstands on skateboards.
Wow.
And you have to name people Tony Alva, Jay Adams. Right. A lot of these guys that had a different vision for what a skateboard competition would look like, and they needed a soundtrack to skate along with inside these emptied out swimming pools, which that was a new phenomenon. Mm-hmm. And they were doing, you know, they were shredding and breaking bones and kicking ass. Mm-hmm. And what an ideal soundtrack. Black Flag, Circle Jerks, Wasted Youth, Germs, Dead Kennedys.
Yeah.
So this was two different worlds that came together, and those probably a lot of the original people were like, what are you guys listening to? And this is horrible. But other people that were influential, like Tony Alva, they know this shit rips and it's cool.
Mm.
And I think that made a form of L.A. hardcore that was different than other sort of nascent punk movements that were going around in the country.
Well, that's interesting, because that the whole skateboard and surf thing really did really brought up punk rock, especially to Southern California. That was such a big influence, because before, I mean, if you watch the Dogtown Z Boys movie, that was before punk. When I remember when I was in, you know, fifth grade, sixth grade, and you would see the magazines with Tony Alva and Stacy Peralta, and you know, these guys were gods back then. And that was all, you know, Zeppelin, Sabbath. You listen to the soundtrack they did for the actual documentary that Sean Penn narrated. It's all Alice Cooper's, Zeppelin and hard rock. And then it kind of transformed just when, you know, Sex Pistols and the Ramones were coming over. Then, of course, you had Dead Kennedys and the whole L.A. punk thing happened. And that, and of course, Suicidal and all the Venice Beach stuff. And that, it just... boom, punk just took over Southern California. And, it, you know, you had your New York punk, you know, you had, you know, Dead Kennedys and your Bay Area stuff, but it seemed like it all centralized in particularly in Orange County by the beaches. Yeah, absolutely.
It's so different nowadays, though. I mean, because when you guys did it, it was different. You didn't have, like, a publicist. You didn't have the internet. There was nothing like that, but yet you guys have remained iconic to everyone, even people that don't really listen to the music, but we've seen the albums. I listen to the music. I've listened to everything, but you see everything out there. Like, how do you think the music business has changed over the years? And it's just different. You know, I never thought it would come to this thing where it's like free internet downloads.
It's another huge subject of debate and discussion, and probably to put a bright spin on it, because it's our reality, whether we like it or not, is that it has closed doors and it opens other doors. Mm. So there's new ways to access literally millions of people that didn't exist before. And you're right, we used to hand out flyers.
Yeah.
Up until even read Travis Barker's book and talking about flyer bombing and pasting flyers all
sure.
over it. So that went on for 20 years. Mm. And now people publicize shows and publicize bands in a different way.
Yeah. Well, it ties in so much together again with the whole metal scene, because that whole do-it-yourself attitude. I mean, I grew up really listening, you know, getting into the new wave of British heavy metal, particularly Motorhead, Saxon, Maiden, and then all these underground bands on Neat Records and Heavy Metal Records, all these labels, and they had that kind of punk philosophy. You know, bands weren't getting signed by the majors, and so all these independent labels started propping up, and, you know, the tape trading and all that kind of stuff, and then, of course, the flyering, even in the early, you know, metal days of L.A., that was, you know, that's what you had to do, flyer to get the attention. You didn't have the support from the labels or the big companies, so... It's interesting how that kind of tied together from that whole do-it-yourself punk movement.
And
attitude.
The fanzines, too, because they didn't have the big magazines. You do your own
That's
thing.
That's what, you know, sparked me to do my little metal fanzine. But it looks like we're going to take another break here. When we get back, we got a lot of stuff to promote. I know you got something going on at NAMM.
Yeah.
Got a lot of great stuff going on. So we're going to be back in 2 minutes on the Inside Metal Show. Coming up.
Geeks, wake up. We've got big news. I'm not going to mumble this time. Geekscape, the long-running movie video game... Let me do one more. Hey geeks, we got big news! Geekscape, your favorite show about movies, video games, comics, and TV, is coming to TradioV Monday, October 6th. And it'll be on every Monday from then on, 7 p.m. Until the apocalypse happens, we're all eaten by zombies.
I'm Zoe Williams.
And I'm Dr. Mark Goulston.
I'm Jeff Brown.
And we make up the Zoe What Morning Show. You can find us here on TRadioV.com every Monday at 11 a.m. Pacific Standard Time. I make you think.
He makes you laugh. And if I get a chance, I'll help you change.
Or make you cry with his attempts at humor.
Radio in TV.
Can you relate? We'll make it happen.
Look at Jeff. What you doing?
Were you mumbling to yourself?
Hey, back there mumbling.
To them. To them.
And it's Mary Carey, of course, politically naughty with Mary Carey.
I'm always naughty. I'm always politically. My behavior is always politically naughty. I'm never politically correct.
Dr. Drew,
hi. Oh, I'm so
guys, how are you?
It's all teary-eyed, doctor.
I know. She wished she could live at rehab.
But only if Dr. Drew's there. Obviously, sure. If someone like, you know, because a little too groping might be inappropriate, but I like the flirting. Well, and stuff.
When I walked in, you shoved my head in your...
No! Are you going to sue me?
Get politically naughty with Mary Carey, Mondays at 4 p.m. on T-Radio V.
All right, some classic Motorhead, of course, with Brian Robertson on guitar. One track, Mine, from the Another Perfect Day album. Back here on the Inside Metal Show, T-Radio V, with my co-host Jasmin St. Clair. And Lucky and Chet Lehrer from Circle Jerks and Wasted Youth, two punk rock icons. And we're going to get into the whole punk scene and metal and how that tied into the thrash metal and all that. I know both your bands were extremely influential on the beginnings of thrash metal, and so many of the bands were inspired by both Circle Jerks and Wasted Youth. But one thing, I know you've got a lot of stuff coming up. We got the NAMM show coming up in a couple weeks.
Is it next week?
No, it's next week. When does it start?
Wednesday?
It's actually, for me, it starts 21st? This Saturday.
Yeah.
The events start on Saturday, the 16th, at Nokia Theater, LA Live, Nokia Theater, and there's Guitar Center's Drum Off. That's hosted by Ringo Starr's drummer, Greg Bissonette.
Oh, cool. Oh,
and I'll be there on the red carpet meeting fans and signing autographs and saying hello and having a great time listening to some of the youngest drumming talent that's coming up. So that's an awesome event for drummers and non-drummers alike.
And that's at Nokia?
And that's at Nokia.
Club Nokia?
Club Nokia, yes.
Cool.
It's where, the one in downtown?
Downtown.
Okay.
The one downtown. Now, Monday night, you know, you talk about, like, again, drums and creativity and unique beats and something more than just boom, bop, boom, bop, boom, bop. A lot of that inspiration came from my exposure to Latin music. And Monday night, there's a huge free?
Yes.
Latin music blowout at Swing House Studios. Super awesome place to go check out. And that's hosted by my brother from another mother, an incredible drummer, Joey Heredia. So that's Joey's second annual Latin drum beat and music event. And that's going to have some legendary Latin drummers. Richie Garcia, Tos Panos, Ronnie Gutierrez is going to play. It's just going to be an incredible festival of free Latin music, and drummers can go pick up some new beats and then try to work them into their metal tunes and their punk tunes, their jazz tunes. I mean, this is really like the spawning ground, Latin music, for any kind of creative drumming. So that's a huge thing. Now, the next night, Tuesday night, that's huge. Tuesday night, I'm going to be playing at the Sidebar in Fullerton at the 2016 All-Star Metal Jam. Mm-hmm. And that's got an absolute ton of people. There's going to be Ira Black from Lizzie Borden. There's going to be Nikki Tedesco. Cool. Alex Kane's going to be there. The singer from The Offspring, Todd Morse, is going to be there. It's just a cast of characters.
I think we got a flyer. Do you have the flyer for
that? And they're posting the flyer right
now.
There
it is. Perfect.
Oh, look at it.
There you go. Look how quick these guys are.
I'm going to go to the Swing House thing, though.
And
that sounds like fun.
Black Sabatoners, our good friend Joey Tafoya. He's playing with Vinny Appice.
Oh, Joey's going to be there?
Yeah, Vinny Appice's going to be there. A drum legend.
Absolutely. And, that's Nick Bocott, who was in Grim Reaper. And he works for Marshall, one of the key dudes at Marshall. Yeah, that's going to be a good show at the Slide Bar in Fullerton.
What time is that? I can't see that far from here.
Looks like 7 p.m. is when it starts.
Yeah, looks like something to
go to,
for sure.
So I definitely come out to that. And that's for anyone could get in.
Looks
and
like,
I think it's cheaper if you have a NAMM badge, but anyone, it's open to the public.
I think it's $20 in advance or $25 at the door, something like that. And speaking of drum legends, Friday night, a huge event dedicated to the man who we all kneel down and worship, John Henry Bonham, at the Bonzo Bash. So there you're going to see some of the world's best drummers. Mike Portnoy is playing this year. Glenn Sobel, the Alice Cooper Band, is going to be there. Chad Smith of the Chili Peppers. Is Lucky playing? 50-50.
Oh, come on. We got to get Lucky
to
play.
Tell us.
There it is, the Bonzo Jam.
Bonzo Band. This is really fun, cool, whether you're playing in it or not. It's your favorite Led Zeppelin songs, and each of these drummers is going to shred one tune. So it is like...
Where is this? Is that, I know
that's at the Observatory. I'm glad you asked.
Oh, because I heard they were doing this somewhere different this year. It is at the Observatory.
It's at the Observatory. Okay, yeah. I believe that's what it said.
The Griffith Park.
No, it's the, it's the old... what was it called before?
The Galaxy Theater?
The Galaxy Theater.
Oh, really? That's gone. That's
Orange
Santa
County.
Ana.
Yeah,
it's
called the Observatory.
It's a great
now.
Venue.
It's a big... Yeah, it's a nice venue.
Are you going to be signing anywhere, either of you, at any booths or any...
Wherever I am, I'm happy to do... And I'm not on my high horse. I'm happy to meet people. It's a... I just say thank you whenever anybody wants a picture. First of all, I'm egotistical, but second of all, it's an honor.
Well, you know, going back to Bonham, I mean, I know you're a huge Bonham fan, and obviously you grew up on Zeppelin and all that. Was it, could you, because again, going back to that, if you were punk, like Led Zeppelin were, you know, they were the enemies. They were the antithesis of.
Not for us.
That's cool, though.
No.
That's, I mean,
they
for everyone else, you you know, you couldn't mention Zeppelin or even Sabbath, you know, and now it kind of ties in. You see Rollins and all these people going back to Sabbath and all that. Back then, you didn't hear any of that, but you were pretty vocal about your influences.
Well, I know Wasted Youth's got a great song that is Alan was very inspired by.
Yeah, we all were. I mean, even back in the day in the 80s and the early 80s, we made it very clear and told everybody who we loved. We grew up with Hendrix and Santana and Robin Trower. I mean,
That's awesome,
live, breathe, and sleep those guys and still do today. And really, for me, that's what makes my heart and soul sing.
I know Dickies kind of crossed over with it. You know, they did Paranoid by Sabbath and, you know, that kind of. And, of course, I remember around that time, you know, the Ramones opened for Sabbath. And they tried to kind of fuse it together, but that didn't work very. I was a little too young to go to that show, but I heard there was
some major fights
there. Even though Ramones aren't really, you know, the hardcore punk as you know you guys were back in the day, but still, it just didn't work.
They were very influential. There's pictures of the Ramones first playing in the UK, and members of the Sex Pistols were watching them, and they hadn't even formed a band yet.
Wow!
So the Ramones were incredibly important. Checker piece in the game board that constitutes the development of punk rock.
Well, you were talking about some earlier, Chet, which I want to get into, because of course the thrash metal, a lot of thrash bands, they cite so many bands, including Wasted Youth. We were just talking, you look at Jeff Hanneman's guitar back in the day, you would see the Wasted Youth and, you know, Dead Kennedys logo all pasted all over his guitar. And Wasted Youth were one of those real crossover bands. I remember DRI, of course, and
Corrosion,
who became a metal band. Funny, because all those bands kind of started as punk. Whether you look at TSOL, they kind of went their metal way. So did Corrosion, Black Flag. You know, Henry Rollins kind of went rock. And even Social Distortion, they didn't go metal, but they went more of a rock and roll kind of thing.
And you even had, like, the Cro-Mags out of
Cro-Mags,
New York.
A New York band.
That was another one,
So talk about how that kind of tied in, because I remember the early... metal thrash shows, you know, after you know, seeing the shows with Slayer at the Woodstock and Radio City, and when the album came out, they started playing the bigger shows. That was when punk really crossed over. When Metallica was playing L.A., it didn't cross over yet. But once Slayer, Dark Angel, you know, our
Death
good friend
Angel.
Came from Hyrax, and then all the Bay Area bands, Death Angel. I think the Bay Area was a little bit more open-minded across a lot of those bands at in the Bay Area shows.
Well, I mean, to me, going back to the beginning, it was Diamond Head that a lot of people listened to.
Cool. Are we going into a break? In a minute. All right, cool. You know, go ahead. Was Diamond Head influential to the punk crowd?
Well, I mean, they definitely were to the metal scene.
Absolutely.
And it was just a matter of time before everything converged and started to cross over. People started exploring and doing new things with music, and it got faster. It got more melodic, and then you had lead. And then so where the punk thing kind of left off, there was a transition. There was a period where metal started to ingrain, or speed metal, or thrash metal, punk metal, death metal, whatever you want to call it, started to evolve around 83. Around 84 is when it really started to blow up and get huge. And for a moment in time, even we, Wasted Youth, we crossed over and started exploring in that arena, and we were playing shows with Death Angel. We played with Exodus, and we started doing that sort of getting into that kind of sound and exploring in that arena.
Oh, I was going to say, I think what inspired a lot of the metalheads, too, was, you as a guitar player, you know, Wasted Youth, you were doing a lot of kind of metal-style leads. And, of course, another band that Suicidal came out, you know, Rocky George. And even on the first Suicidal record, just Institutionalized, there's shredding guitar throughout. And that was kind of unheard of back in the punk days until, you know, you guys started kind of introducing more of a metal-style guitar sound.
Yeah, I mean, that's sounds fairly accurate, and something that just was meant to be. It was the music changed, leads were getting thrash, metal, distortion, fast music, double bass, started to really take on a life of its own. And all these different areas like San Francisco and L.A. and, you know, Europe, They were really the birthplace for this kind of music.
Absolutely. I think we're going into another break here. Little Motorhead, Killed by Death. We're going to be back on our final segment, correct? Yes. Final segment coming up next.
Oh.
T-Radio V, Inside Metal. Oh. T-Radio B Inside Metal Show, our final segment.
Yeah.
It goes fast, doesn't it, guys?
Time flies when you're
all
having
right.
fun.
Lucky, Chet, and Jasmin, our final segment here. I know there was a few things. We already pumped your upcoming shows. NAMM definitely come out.
Are you doing anything for NAMM?
No, I'm just going to check things out and see how things are looking, really.
If you need security, let me know.
Okay.
No, she could kick some ass, let me tell you. Let's talk about, you wanted to talk a little bit about the shows you used to do with Black Flag and
Dez
and some of the...
Yeah, I skipped kind of a piece. I kind of glossed over Dez, which was a mistake. I was in a band with him, and I was in Red Kross, and there was two guitarists, and it was Dez and I. And when that lineup kind of broke up, Dez went into Black Flag before Henry.
Mm.
And then he remained in the band when Henry sang as a guitarist with Greg again.
Right.
And so I have really good memories of Dez. He's a super guy. And moving forward, then he joined up with the Misfits with Robo, the original drummer.
It's funny how it all ties in like that.
But Dez is a super guy.
Mm. A lot of people may remember Lucky actually toured with Bad Religion for a little while. Yeah.
Which that is that was in the days when if you stayed at a Motel 6, you thought it was like a five-star place. I mean, it was a very – it was – well, put it this way. We landed at JFK. We went into a Subway. And putting all your drums on a Subway,
wow.
You know, it was very – we've said do-it-yourself several times. This was worse than do-it-yourself.
CBGB's?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Sure. Wow. All those early places.
That's awesome.
Irving Palace. I mean, Peppermint Lounge. We had great shows, great turnout. Lots of fun.
All right. Right. Well, cool, man. So this is our final segment. Was there anything else we didn't touch that
we were talking
about
the Cuckoo's Nest earlier, and we played a show there with Black Flag, and it was interesting. They had matinee shows back in those days, which really wasn't that happening in terms of what was going on in Santa Monica and Hollywood and the Valley. They would do a show in the afternoon,
right?
And then they'd do one in the evening. And I remember that being very different.
Was that Rodney Bingenheimer? Because I know he did matinee shows at the Whiskey way back at the.
I don't recall
Punk-O-Rama.
Don't recall punk shows. Maybe before the punk thing with Rodney. I mean, Rodney goes back a million years.
Yeah,
in the 60s,
that was.
But
yeah,
but they were doing some punk shows during the day at the Cuckoo's Nest.
Wow,
there was a time when the conventional venues banned punk, and so it needed to get very creative as far as where the shows would be held, and that in itself could be a movie, because what often happened is a promoter would wave $200 or $300 at someone whose job was running an American Legion hall or a Polish veterans hall, and these guys hadn't seen that kind of money for one night in years. And they thought they were laughing. They thought they were going to laugh their way to the bank with that $200 or $300. Yeah. And later that evening, they'd leave one guy to supervise the whole thing. And then what ensued should be the subject of a movie, and is definitely the subject of a lot of hysterical memories. Because at the Polish Hall, the destruction, the mayhem that was caused. Because what started happening was, in order for a gig to be recognized as a good gig, it was how much damage got inflicted on the venue.
I remember some of those old places. Metal Arc, that old country club in Huntington Beach, and Eugene's out in East L.A.
A country club?
No, it was not the country club in Reseda. It was like a golf course, but it was all beat up.
Yeah, they played in a golf course?
And like a little little place there. And of course, Mike Muir used to do all the Triple Amoeba do shows in Watts and wherever. You know, a lot of the early thrash shows.
Yeah, you're thinking about the
Balboa, Vex. Balboa Theater and the Vex.
And Bards Apollo.
Vex
was huge. Downs and,
but anywhere you could, any promoter would just gut a place and throw a punk rock show. And
I remember walking to some of those shows, and of course the neighborhood, it was a real yin and yang as far as the neighbors, and it was a collision of completely different. I mean, these were inner city people that were looking at us like, what are you doing here? And like, pretty much like, should I use my Uzi? Should I use my 45? Should I use my Glock? I mean, it was a complete two different worlds meeting each other.
It wasn't like the House of Blues.
Well,
or
was it like in Compton or something?
Then.
You had these
problems.
So what did they have, like Bloods or Crips there that
Watts,
wanted to like? How did you actually avoid that? Did like follow? You just kept your face straight. Just don't even look at them. Don't make eye contact and just go.
Well, it's kind of like what's that place in Detroit now where they always have famous place in Detroit? Anyway. I know we only got a minute left, he's saying, so we'll, you've been in so many movies too. I know, well, Circle Jerks were featured in Repo Man.
Yeah.
We'll just talk about that. And of course, Decline, the first Decline movie, and a couple other punk movies.
And for some reason, I'm drawing a blank on some of them. There was one that went like punk across the country, but I forget the name of that movie.
Oh, the American Hardcore.
That's a great
documentary.
Yeah.
That's, in fact, my documentary, I based a lot. I wanted to make kind of the heavy metal version of that, because I look at that and I go, why can't they do something on metal? Every time they do a documentary about metal guys, they come off so fucking lame.
Mm-hmm.
And here in this American hardcore, all the punk guys come off really intelligent and
fun.
And fun. It's like, so that was, I actually took a lot of influence. Whoever directed American Hardcore, I can't remember his name offhand, but fantastic
movie.
You're
the man, yes.
So,
and there's a Circle Jerks movie that's out.
Oh,
yeah,
there is.
Cool.
Yeah.
For some reason, I'm drawing a blank on the name.
Where, when?
I don't know. I guess you have to like okay. Google it.
All right. Well, contacts. I know there's guys that want to contact you both. So
www.luckylehrer.com and on Facebook and Twitter.
And that's Lehrer. And Chet?
I'm pretty much lead a low profile with people that want to get a hold of me now, too. So.
And you guys never really were in too many bands together, huh? You just jammed a little bit? It was always separate.
We played
huh?
some shows together. We had some really good shows together where both bands appeared.
Yeah.
And those were good memories.
Was it competition? Like, I'm going to kick your ass, bro. My band's going to. No?
I don't know. We friendly.
We did our thing cool. and they did theirs and we had a lot of fun, yeah.
Cool. All right. Well, I guess the show's over, guys.
Yes.
Thank you. Our new producer is here, man. Excellent job.
Bye.
Thank you, fellas.
Awesome. Thank you.
All right. Once again, support these guys. We're going to be back. We got to have you guys back on, man.
Yeah,
because there's so much to talk about on the whole punk era. Don't forget to check them out at NAMM, the show at the Slide Bar, and of course the Bonzo Bash, where you'll be getting to do a song. What Zeppelin song do you want to play if you get up there? What would be your choice?
I'd be happy to play any of them. Each one of them's a jewel. Cashmere would be high awesome. On the list, but there's a lot of great songs.
Very cool, man. All right. Inside Metal, T-Radio V. We'll be back next week.
Bye.
Cool. Yeah, these shows are
you are watching T-Radio V, radio and TV.